tonight. The First Minister rejects calls to suspend Nicola Sturgeon from the SNP following her arrest, as opposition leaders and even some members of her own party call for her to stand down.
I won't be suspending Nicola Sturgeon. I'll be treating her exactly in the same way as I treated, for example, Colin Beattie, both released without charge, and therefore there's no reason for me to suspend them.
And from one former leader causing problems for their successor to another, we have the latest on what's in store for Boris Johnson following his resignation. Also making the headlines, Scotland's murder rates fall to the lowest level since modern records began.
And we meet two female scientists from Edinburgh University doing extraordinary work with NASA.
I'm John Mackay in Glasgow.
And I'm Kellyanne Woodland in Edinburgh. This is the STV News at 6.
Good evening. The First Minister has rejected calls to suspend Nicola Sturgeon from the SNP following her arrest. Hamza Yousaf says he will treat the former party leader the same as other members who were arrested and released without charge.
Nicola Sturgeon was interviewed for more than 7 hours yesterday as part of an investigation into SNP finances and fundraising, while opposition parties have accused the First Minister of weakness for failing to take action. Our political editor Colin Mackay joins us now. And Colin, what a story.
Absolutely. The highest profile figure in Scottish politics over the last 10 years. One of the biggest names in British politics. Arrested by Police Scotland. Questioned as a suspect before being released without charge. Now, Nicola Sturgeon strongly proclaims her innocence, which is pretty bullish after 7 hours of questioning by the police yesterday. And today, opposition leaders, even some SNP MSPs, calling for Nicola Sturgeon to stand down as an SNP MSP, certainly from the party anyway. What drama, as Ewan Petrie now reports.
The job of First Minister can be quite busy. It can have its own stresses.
The arrest of Nicola Sturgeon will no doubt have added to those stresses. As he opened a national treatment centre in Inverness, the First Minister faced mounting pressure to suspend the former SNP leader. She is the third senior figure in the party to be arrested as part of a police investigation into more than £600,000 of donations.
No, I won't be suspending Nicola Sturgeon. I'll be treating her exactly in the same way as I treated, for example, Colin Beattie, both released without charge, and therefore there's no reason for me to suspend them. I can only account for the decisions that I make, and I'm aiming to be as consistent in my approach to this, and I have shown that consistency because when individuals have been released without charge, let me emphasise that, without charge, therefore I see no reason to suspend them.
It's more than 2 months since police carried out an extensive search of Nicola Sturgeon's home. It followed the arrest of her husband, the SNP's former chief executive, Peter Murrell. Officers also raided the party's headquarters in Edinburgh. Almost 2 weeks later, Treasurer Colin Beattie was also arrested. Both were released without charge.
I could not have anticipated in my worst nightmares what would have unfolded over the past few weeks.
Those nightmares have deepened for the former First Minister, but she has the full support of her successor.
I don't know if there were backroom deals done, but clearly it looks like he is supporting Nicola Sturgeon and Peter Murrell because they supported his bid to become leader of the SNP and then First Minister. And I think that is terrible, I think it's unacceptable, and it is extremely weak by Hamza Yousaf.
Ultimately, that's a decision for the SNP about what they do in reaction, but if you look at previous cases in the SNP, there have been suspensions, and the question is whether he's strong enough or whether he's too weak.
Among the previous cases of suspension is Michelle Thompson. She claims she was forced to resign the whip as an MP, despite never personally being under investigation.
I think that Nicola Sturgeon should step aside from the SNP whip temporarily whilst the investigation is underway. Now, the reason I think that's the case is that she herself set precedent over a number of different cases.
Nicola Sturgeon maintains she is innocent, but pressure on her successor is likely to intensify. when he returns to Holyrood tomorrow. Ewan Petrie, STV News.
So, Colin, what happens next?
Well, in terms of the police investigation, we just don't know. Yesterday was actually a bit different from the two previous arrests. There was no early morning raid on Nicola Sturgeon's home this time. She was called on Saturday by detectives to arrange a time for the arrest. Now, police say a report will now be sent to the Procurator Fiscal, but after almost 2 years of Operation Branch Form, we don't know if it's nearly finished or even if any charges will ultimately be brought. But politically, this is explosive stuff. It's a gift for the SNP's opponents. There are open wounds now in the SNP, with SNP MSPs and an MP calling on Nicola Sturgeon to stand down, to give up her membership during this police investigation. And as you heard in Ewan's report there, First Minister Humza Yousaf saying today that because there is no charge as of yet, there is no reason to suspend Nicola Sturgeon or any of the others. But he's also making it clear that if any charges are brought, things could be very different. But we will see Nicola Sturgeon in the Parliament this week, I'm told, probably on Wednesday, to take questions from journalists. But that will be nothing compared to questions from the police.
All right, Colin, thanks very much for that. Well, another former leader causing problems for their successor is Boris Johnson, who has tonight officially quit as an MP. He'd been given advance notice of a report that's expected to be published this week into whether he deliberately lied to Parliament over Partygate.
There's also been a bitter row over the former Prime Minister's failed attempt to give some of his closest friends places in the House of Lords. It's led to a deepening rift with the current Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, as our Westminster editor Catherine Sampson reports.
Boris Johnson's backing away from Parliament, but his row with Rishi Sunak still running. Today, the Prime Minister suggested Mr Johnson asked him to overrule a panel vetting people he wanted to put into the House of Lords.
Boris Johnson asked me to do something that I wasn't prepared to do because I didn't think it was right. That was to either overrule the HOLAC committee or to make promises with people. Now, I wasn't prepared to do that. As I said, I didn't think it was right. And if people don't like that, then tough.
Boris Johnson later responded to this, saying his successor was talking rubbish. Two Johnson allies, Nadine Dorries and Nigel Evans, quit as MPs after being denied peerages. It's left the Prime Minister coping with three by-elections. And that's not all. A report out soon is expected to conclude Boris Johnson deliberately lied to Parliament over Partygate. For some, this drags up painful memories of the pandemic. Heather Stewart's husband, Stephen, spent a month in hospital before he died of COVID at just 45. She still suffers from the long-term effects.
It's a blatant lies that they've stood there and told us. My life is changed in so many ways, and there's so many people like me who didn't get the chance to say goodbye, but they thought it was fine to have a party to say goodbye to a colleague. It's totally unbelievable and beyond forgiveness in my eyes.
But Boris Johnson believes he's been the victim of a political hit job.
The only person accountable and responsible for Boris Johnson's downfall is Boris Johnson himself. And I think the British people are so tired of this soap opera.
But not everyone thinks the former Prime Minister has definitely run out of road.
You can never make predictions about someone as mercurial as Boris. So who knows what the future will hold.
Whatever happens, it's unlikely Rishi Sunak has seen the back of a predecessor who casts a very long shadow.
Let's go to Catherine at Westminster. And Catherine, there's potentially more trouble to come.
Yeah, look, a real war of words between Rishi Sunak and Boris Johnson today. And of course, now we're waiting for the Privileges Committee to drop that report into whether they have found that Boris Johnson deliberately misled or lied to Parliament over Partygate. The steer is, and we should get that by Wednesday this week. Now, of course, Boris Johnson has seen the findings already. We have not. Judging by the response he had on Friday, that furious exit statement, you can assume it's not good good news for him. Also, this is not good news for a prime minister either, to have these issues dragged back into the press after a relative period of calm. Interesting today, though, to note a difference in approach with Rishi Sunak and his predecessor, a prime minister who seems very keen to put some clear blue water between himself and Boris Johnson. Humza Yousaf playing things a lot more carefully when it comes to Nicola Sturgeon.
Catherine at Westminster, thank you. Well, away from politics, and Scotland was once called the most violent country in the developed world, but now the homicide rate has fallen to the lowest level since modern records began almost 50 years ago.
It's a remarkable turnaround since the early 2000s when the number of killings peaked. Much of it is being put down to taking a different approach to dealing with violence. Here's our senior reporter, Gordon Cree.
It was stab or be stabbed.
This campaign video from the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit is part of tackling the problem using a public health model. That means looking at the root causes to try to prevent it from happening in the first place.
That was my life.
It's things like poverty, it's things like education, it's like tackling things like addiction issues, mental health issues. It's actually getting in about our communities and working with our communities and not working against them. It's about stopping the causes of the violence, not just dealing with the symptoms.
And that approach over the past two decades has been transformational. In 2004-2005, there were 137 homicides in Scotland. In the last year, that number was just 48. Tony Ferns was murdered in Glasgow in 2019. That is the only one committed since Police Scotland was formed a decade ago to remain unsolved.
I think it's down to a variety of factors. Yes, there's been developments in technology and science, particularly DNA. However, you still have to have investigators and detectives at the back of that who are becoming very, very skilled and experienced in what they do.
In the last year, two historic cases have also seen killers successfully prosecuted. Brenda Page was murdered in Aberdeen in 1978. As were Renee McRae and her three-year-old son Andrew in the Highlands 2 years earlier. Her sister summed up what getting a conviction means for a family.
We've waited a long time for it, and to be honest, I never really thought I would hear the guilty verdict. So I just was delighted today to get justice.
20 years ago, Scotland was getting international condemnation for its level of violence. But now the work being done here to cut those crimes is starting to be replicated around the world. Gordon Cree, STV News, Glasgow.
Other stories, and firefighters are continuing to battle a wildfire which began on Saturday afternoon in the Highlands. At its height, six fire engines were sent to the blaze near Inverness. Two appliances remain on the scene. Those staying nearby have been advised to close all windows and doors to prevent smoke inhalation.
And train drivers have rejected a pay offer from ScotRail. 51.6% of ASLEF union members voted to turn down the proposed 5% pay rise. ASLEF says the offer is below inflation and called for talks to reopen. Now, one of Scotland's leading doctors says people have been left destroyed by the impact of contamination issues at Glasgow's Royal Children's Hospital. And the strain placed on staff delivering cancer care for young patients was huge.
Professor Brenda Gibson, a consultant paediatric haematologist, is giving evidence to the Scottish Hospitals Inquiry, which was set up in the wake of deaths linked to infections at the hospital campus. Here's our chief reporter, Sharon Frew.
Ahead of the move into the multi-million pound hospital, the lead of York Hill's Schehallion Children's Cancer Unit was expected to sign off on plans for the new wards. Professor Brenda Gibson told the inquiry she held off and never did this. In the end, the signature was provided by a senior nurse.
We have been promised a like-for-like unit in a flagship hospital, and it certainly wasn't a like-for-like, you know, unit.
This inquiry has previously heard, following the 2015 opening, that the super hospital had multiple problems. Contamination issues were linked to the water quality and ventilation systems. When the number of potentially fatal infections increased, it was decided young cancer patients should be transferred to the neighbouring adult hospital. Parents told the inquiry they were at breaking point. Professor Gibson says staff felt the same.
Some people have described themselves as destroyed. It was significant. I've never seen a toll taken on staff like it. One has to recognise that the biggest toll was taken by the parents, but this is about the strain on some of the, particularly the nursing staff, was huge.
Expertise. Professor Gibson was taken through records of the NHS board's responses to the repeated concerns raised by clinicians. In one letter, staff demanded an external review to ensure infection control measures were adequate. It took over 3 years before young cancer patients were moved back to the Children's Hospital. The Schehallion unit reopened after an £11 million refurbishment.
I do think we are a great team. I built the unit and I'm very proud of each and every one of them who's worked in it and, you know, and has survived this. And we just want everybody to appreciate that we did do our best and that we did try endlessly to bring attention to the concerns we had to those above us.
The inquiry will hear from more clinicians over the coming days. Sharon Frew, STV News.
Police are appealing for any information that could help trace a prisoner who absconded from HMP Castle Huntly last night. 39-year-old Sean McGovern has been serving a sentence for dealing heroin and firing a shotgun outside a pub in Edinburgh's Broomhouse area. The public are being asked not to approach him. Now, it sounds like something straight out of a disaster movie. One female scientist in Edinburgh is working on a way to protect the Earth from devastating collisions with asteroids, whilst another predicts we'll discover other habitable planets in the next 20 years. Our reporter, Ivana Holland, went along to meet them at the University of Edinburgh.
Exploration of planets outside our solar system has always been a fascination for Professor Biller. Her work with the James Webb Space Telescope is focused on identifying the makeup of a multitude of orbs in our galaxy. But she predicts another habitable planet will be discovered in our time.
I think it will happen in 20 to 30 years. My best guess is that it will take the next round of space missions, like the successor to JWST, to really do that.
But what will that mean practically for us Earth dwellers?
Understanding if any of them are habitable, maybe looking to see if we can find signs of life. That's a very challenging thing to do. And just understanding, you know, how common are planets like our own? What do solar systems look like in general?
The James Webb Telescope was launched in 2021 with scientific instruments built here in Edinburgh as a successor to Hubble.
This telescope, when it was used in the 1920s right up to the 70s, was considered to be at the forefront of its technology. Used a mirror inside that was about a metre wide in diameter. Now compare that with the James Webb Space Telescope, which is more than 6 times greater in size, and is considered to be the most advanced piece of technology used in space science today. Now, the unique work of these University of Edinburgh scientists is really underpinning its status in the field of astronomy.
Not even a 50-yard walk away, another field of research is making ground. Professor Oppatom is helping to save the world. Well, when you break her rule down, she's analysing the makeup of asteroids in order to learn how to push them off course should they ever pose a threat to Earth, which NASA did last September by crashing a spacecraft into a moon called Dimorphos.
NASA wanted a change of at least 73 seconds of that orbit. And we actually had a change of 33 minutes. So it was very, very successful. We can really understand what the surface of the asteroids was made of, for example, and better understand asteroids in general, which is a step to better understand our own solar system and how it formed and evolved.
Her work may sound like a film, but it's far from reality.
In real life, it's sometimes a bit less glamorous than a movie. It's a lot of time staring, looking at computer screen and analyzing data, but it's also extremely exciting. I often feel like a small kid and that gets to play with a new toy.
The work being done by these women is both astronomical in size and importance. Ivana Holland, STV News, Edinburgh.
To the sport now, and rumours swirling over who the next Celtic manager is going to be. Ronnie, maybe you can give us some clarity.
Wishful thinking there, as ever, Jono. It's certainly the hot topic in Scottish football at the moment, isn't it? Today, we got a little bit of movement. Good evening. Celtic have held initial talks with former boss Brendan Rodgers about becoming the club's new manager. The Northern Irishman won 7 trophies in a row in his previous spell before controversially leaving for Leicester City. We understand Rodgers is one of the top targets to take over from Ange Postecoglou, and the Celtic hierarchy have met with him to discuss a potential return. Well, another name in contention is Bodo Glimt boss Kjetil Knutsen, and former Celtic striker Harald Brattbakk says his fellow countryman would be a great candidate for the job. Knutsen has won two Norwegian titles and previously knocked Celtic out of the Europa Conference League. Brattbakk says his European pedigree would make him a suitable for the Parkhead hot seat.
He would be a good candidate because he was picked by the Bodø/Glimt team. They've been scouting him for years, so they knew what his qualities were. In Scotland, it's okay. One thing is winning the league, but what do you do when you come to Europe and play international matches? That's the next step. But he has also proven with less resources that he can do well. So he would definitely be a good candidate.
Ryan Kent has joined Turkish side Fenerbahce on a four-year deal after leaving Rangers. The winger joined the Ibrox club from Liverpool for £7 million in 2019, but was not offered a new deal when his contract expired. He made more than 200 appearances, scoring 33 goals in that time. St Mirren manager Stephen Robinson says he's ready to keep building after extending his contract until the summer of 2026. The 48-year-old guided the Buddies to their most successful league campaign since 1985 last season, when they finished in the top six for the first time. Now, managing director of the Scottish Women's Premier League, Fiona McIntyre, has been reflecting on what she describes as a fantastic and historic season for women's football. Despite admitting there's still work to be done in society to change attitudes towards females and the sport, McIntyre insists this season was just the tip of the iceberg in terms of growth in the game.
Season 22-23 will take some beating when it comes to women's football. Record attendances, more media exposure than ever, and a three-way final day decider for the league title. But the woman at the helm in Scotland is clear. This is just the beginning.
It was a fantastic season, I think illustrated by the end of the season where we had full stadiums, games on television, great viewing numbers, and most importantly, everyone was talking about women's football, everyone was talking about that final day of the season. So yeah, I don't think it could have gone any better in our first year, and we're absolutely delighted.
How have you seen society and the stigma of women's football sort of shift? Is there still more to be done in that societal aspect?
It probably does still exist, otherwise we'd have 50,000 people in stadiums instead of 15,000. But I think that takes time to cultivate that relationship between a football team and spectators. So from my perspective, I don't see a lot of negativity. I see a lot of positivity and doors opening rather than doors closing. When I played football, I was the girl that played football, and that came from the fact that I was the only, or one of two girls, I think, in my entire school that played football. I've now got two little girls, and they just see girls and women's football as the norm. I think just that normalisation that girls play football and that these female role models can be role models for everyone, that's probably the kind of greatest achievement that I see in recent years.
Despite the recent success, an ongoing issue in the women's game is the legal dispute between the national team and the SFA over equal pay and conditions. The players say there are disparities between their treatment and that of their male counterparts.
Yeah, I think everyone wants these things resolved quickly. Nobody wants to dwell on anything that's negative, and we've just spoken about the success of this season in the SWPL, how well the national team are playing, and that's what we want the headlines to be.
The SWPL will be looking to build on last season's success, and it all starts on the 3rd of July when the fixtures for the new campaign are announced.
To boxing, and Josh Taylor admits he's devastated after losing his world title and unbeaten record in a unanimous decision against Teofimo Lopez in New York. The East Lothian fighter was off the pace for the crucial match-winning rounds in the middle of the bout, and afterwards pointed to moving up a weight division for his next stage of his career.
The layoff had nothing to do with it. I've got no excuses, you know, he was better on the night. I think probably I'll probably most likely be moving up to light welter now, but you know, no excuses. He was a better man tonight. I've no excuses, so well done.
Finally, Andy Murray continued his preparations for Wimbledon by winning his first grass court title since his victory at the All England Club in 2016. The Scot secured the Surbiton Trophy at the weekend after a straight sets win against Jurij Rodionov. He'll now play at the Rothesay Open Nottingham this week ahead of the Grand Slam next month. That is all your sport tonight. Join us again tomorrow. We'll hear from the Scotland camp ahead of Norway and Georgia in the Euro qualifiers.
All right, thanks very much for that, Ronnie. Well, I think we could get used to this gorgeous weather, couldn't we? Let's get the forecast now from Sean.
It's looking like a chilly one. TUI sponsors STV Weather.
A very good evening to you. There's been a few thunderstorms around today. Thundery showers across the southwest and also the northwest here. We've avoided those and we've held on to that very gentle easterly breeze holding the temperatures back slightly along the coast. But of course, we've had some very warm weather, especially inland, 25 to 26 degrees. And that's going to be the case over the next couple of days. And overnight tonight, dry with clear spells, temperatures about 12 or 13 degrees Celsius. Tomorrow morning, it's dry, lots of sunshine around. But again, like today, we will see some showers getting sparked off. I think it's the southern uplands that will spark off most for us, but generally the showers staying to the west, perhaps a few just clipping the lights of West Lothian and perhaps into Falkirk, Clackmannanshire. But for most of us, it is just a dry day, a sunny day, and those highs, even coastal parts, 23 degrees, but we're still up to 27 or 28, possibly further inland. So feeling hot out there in that sunshine during tomorrow, and it stays that way over the next couple of days. I always expect those temperatures around coastal parts to be a bit lower than they will be further inland. Now, the temperatures across western parts, 27, 28 tomorrow, but they're coming down to about 24, 25 as we go through the week. Slightly fresher air coming in, so the good thing is we will start to lose the humidity. I expect though on Friday, as our winds start to swing round to more of a southerly to southwesterly, in coastal areas we'll be around the mid-20s, could be about 25 or 26 in the capital, so a warm week ahead. Bye-bye.
TUI sponsors STV Weather.
Well, I'm off to enjoy that weather. How about you, John? Beer garden?
I've got Scotland tonight, 10:40. Do you think anyone would notice? Nah, better not risk it. Okay. Good night.
Good night.